Hello and welcome to this Lexology webinar. My name is Umair Rahim. I'm an editor here at Lexology, and I'd like to thank everyone for tuning in. So we have a really great presentation today from Dechert on vertical mergers, assessing antitrust risk and maximizing clearance prospects. Before we get started, there are just a few admin points I wanted to mention for all the attendees and the press. Please use the online question tool to post any questions that you may have, and the speakers will aim to respond to these during the session. For any questions the speakers do not get around to answering during the session, these will be sent to them and they will endeavor to get back to you at a later stage. If you have any audio visual problems during the presentation, please let us know by using the online question tool and we will do our best to resolve them. The recording of this session and the accompanying slides will be posted online and we will send a link to all webinar attendees. Please use the link and send on to any colleagues who you think may be interested in today's presentation. So without further ado, I'd like to hand over to Laurence, who will get us started.
Good morning, everyone, or good afternoon for those who, like me, are in the EU. Today, we are going to talk about vertical mergers. So first thing first, what exactly is a vertical merger? Well, unlike horizontal mergers, which are mergers between competitors, vertical mergers see a combination between firms that operate at different levels of the supply chain. So instead of competing with each other, they provide the other merging party or its rivals with something they use in competition. For example, it can be a manufacturer merging with a supplier of raw materials, a manufacturer merging with a supplier of a specific technology that they use in their own product, a supplier merging with one of your distributors or retailers. In the AT&T Time Warner case, for example, it was a supplier of telephone and internet link that merged with a provider of content that could be provided through the telephone and internet services of AT&T. So today we are going to cover a number of topics that are related to these vertical mergers, and we'll take questions along the way, so do not hesitate if you have any to type them in the box. Our first topic, obviously, will be why are we hearing so much about vertical mergers right now? Our second topic, how are vertical mergers analyzed on both sides of the Atlantic and how does this analysis differ from horizontal mergers? Third topic, what should you expect in terms of process, timing, any practical issue? And then we'll come to the heart of our subject, which is how can you maximize your prospects for clearance? And that will be based on the extensive experience that the Dechert panel that is here today have on merger, on vertical mergers, both before the US authorities and the European Commission. And then fifth topic, how can you remedy concerns, if any remains? And finally, we'll conclude with a few tips on how you can assess whether your vertical merger deal is likely to be scrutinized either in the US or in the EU. And to guide us on all these topics, I'm very lucky to be surrounded by amazing panelists today. Dechert attorneys have represented parties in as much as one third of the significant US vertical mergers investigations since 2017. We have longstanding experience with vertical mergers before the European Commission as well. So, let me introduce myself. I'm Laurence Paris. I'm a national partner with Dechert in Paris. I've worked on a number of vertical mergers that have been cleared by the European Commission, either in phase one or in phase two. And I have the privilege to be moderating this panel today. With me, you have my partner, Alec Burnside in Brussels, who has a very long-standing experience of vertical mergers before the European Commission and was, for instance, recently involved in the Bayer-Monsanto case. Then we have Craig Falls, a partner in our DC office, a specialist on antitrust issues that arise from vertical relationships, a recent contributor to the revision of the vertical guidelines in the US, and he dealt with the vertical merger issues in, for example, in Danone White Wave. Then we have Rennie Abash, also a partner in our DC office, who was in particular involved in a deal that you've probably heard about, CVS Aetna. And finally, last but not least, we have Michael Wiener, a partner in our New York office, who has a very long experience of vertical mergers and most recently worked on the Fresenius Next Stage deal. So Michael, we'll start with you. Companies have been vertically integrating for a very long time. It's not something that is new. So why do you think we are hearing so much about vertical merger just now?
So you're right, Laurence. We have been hearing about vertical mergers for some time. There have been concerns about vertical mergers for some time. They date back to and before the 1984 non-horizontal merger guidelines issued by the FTC and the Department of Justice. Those guidelines back in 84 were heavily influenced by the Chicago School's observation that vertical mergers resulted in the elimination of double marginalization. And they stated that non-horizontal mergers were not, and I quote, invariably innocuous, but not terribly pro-enforcement in that language. But there's been a degree of consistency even between the circumstances in which the 84 guidelines said that vertical mergers could result in increasing entry barriers and the more recently articulated concerns that we're going to talk about, like foreclosure of horizontal competitors from access to an input or a downstream market or raising rivals' costs or access to competitively sensitive information. Those have been the sources of concern by the agencies for literally for decades now. So there's not a lot of new in the theory. So why the attention to vertical mergers today? I'm thinking of four different reasons. Number one, we're in a campaign season, and some, like Senator Warren, depicted here, are saying that antitrust enforcement is too lax, and giving vertical mergers a free pass leads to the accumulation of too much market power and too much political power in the hands of large competitors. As one of my colleagues has remarked, antitrust is cool again. Second, this is the draft DOJ-FTC vertical merger guidelines released in January. That draft provoked controversy. There were three individual statements by FTC commissioners. There were 74 sets of comments that were filed. One public hearing has been held before COVID got in the way. So the draft guidelines have been a source of increased focus on vertical mergers. Third, the recent memory of high-profile cases like AT&T Time Warner, the first vertical merger case tried in decades, and one in which the DOJ declined to accept conduct remedies. And fourth, the apparent distinction between DOJ and FTC with regard to accepting conduct remedies. It's unusual that the agencies, the outcome can depend on which agency you go to. And while both agencies have expressed a preference for structural relief, the FTC has continued to accept firewalls and other conduct restrictions in appropriate cases, like Staples Ascendant last year, deals involving Corpus Christi Polymers, and Northrop Grumman the year before. Whereas at the DOJ, I think you have to go back to 2016 to find an example of a case in which the DOJ accepted a conduct remedy to resolve vertical merger concerns. And even in that case, which was AMC Carmike, there were also divestitures required, and the transaction was primarily horizontal. So that difference between the agencies attracts critical attention. So to sum it up, why are we hearing about vertical mergers now? Because of politics, because of the draft guidelines, because of AT&T Time Warner, and because the agencies seem to be very different in terms of their approach. But having said that, I don't think that there's a renewed focus on vertical mergers by the agencies. There is an increased focus by politicians and commenters. So that's the story in the States. Alec, is there any change in focus on vertical mergers by the European Commission?
Michael, the change in Europe was many years ago. If I take the historical route, of course, everything vertical is more of interest in Europe in a sense, in the sense that European antitrust law is all about integrating national markets as well as maintaining free competition. So in distribution agreements, of course, the vertical aspects were controlled more in Europe than in the US. But in relation to mergers, verticals were there from the very beginning as a possible theory of harm. The European Commission got up to speed slowly after 1990 when the merger regulation was new and soon was punching mergers out of the sky with gay abandon until it was really pushed back hard by the European Court in 2002 in three judgments overturning mergers. Leading up to that moment, there had been some vigorous intervention on vertical cases or conglomerate cases, General Electric, Honeywell, Tetra Laval, the Portuguese gas and electricity case. After that, the European Commission went through a period of sobering up, getting some orthodox economic advice, putting in proper checks and balances. And vertical enforcement is still there, but it's not particularly vigorous. Statistics I have say that in the period 2015 to 2018, of the cases in which the European Commission intervened, be it with the phase one remedy or in phase two, only 10% were vertical in character. There are vertical cases going on. In fact, I'll mention later on one which is brand new in the headlines. But vertical mergers as such are not a focus of interest. We have consultations going on for review of the horizontal guidelines. We've got all kinds of excitement about new ex-ante tools for controlling digital companies, control of foreign subsidies, great cases around oligopolies and unilateral effects. Verticals are a fact of life, but not really active very much in amongst the antitrust chattering classes.
Thank you very much, both. That brings us to our next subject, which is how are vertical merger analyzed, in particular compared to a horizontal case. And Craig, you are our specialist of vertical issues here. What's your take on this?
So at the outset, I'd say that the vertical merger analysis is very different than the horizontal analysis. And to see why, I'm going to spend a minute just reminding everyone how horizontal mergers are analyzed. So in a horizontal merger, you have a combination of two companies that compete with each other. In every single horizontal merger, you're going to lose that head-to-head competition between the two merging parties. In every horizontal merger, you're going to have one fewer independent participant in the market. And you're going to also have an increase in concentration. And the combination of the market shares of the two parties to the merger will be put together, and you may look at those combined market shares and say, you know, does this new firm have a large control of a large sector of the market? But in a vertical merger, you have none of that. So we'll look at the chart here to help understand. But in a vertical merger, there's no loss of any head-to-head competition. There's no loss of there's no loss of an independent player participating in either level of the market. There's no increase in market concentration. So what are the theories of harm? There are four theories that I'll go through, and I'll go to them at a pretty high level given the constraints of this program. But first, we have to look at the relationship here between the parties. It will help understand the theories. So as Laurence mentioned at the beginning, a vertical merger is not just a vertical merger because the parties are operating at different levels of a supply chain. There, what makes it a vertical merger is that they're operating at different levels of the same supply chain. So the importance of that is that one party to the merger is providing something that the other party to the merger and or its rivals finds useful to competition. Laurence gave you some upstream examples. It could be for example, in this chart here, merging party A could be providing a raw material or a component of a finished product or a manufacturing service or something upstream, or merging party A could be downstream and providing a transportation service. It could be providing a distribution channel. It could be a retailer, or it could be someone who finances transactions for consumers of merging party B. There can be a lot of different examples, but the essential takeaway is that merging party A in this diagram here is providing something that merging party B and its rivals find useful when they're competing. So what happens when the parties get together and they have a vertical merger is, well, now merging party B under common ownership with merging party A may have an incentive not to provide that service to its rivals anymore. And so the common theory that we hear about most often in vertical mergers is the theory of foreclosure. The idea that if that, whatever that service is or product is that's being denied to competitors would weaken those rivals in competition, then there's maybe an incentive for the merged firm not to continue supplying it. Well, that's not always going to be the case. The merging parties do make some money off of those sales. They make some profit off those sales to the rivals. So the question is it more profitable to continue supplying the rivals with that service or input, or is it more profitable to deny the rivals access to that input and then hope to gather sales downstream? And that requires some analysis to understand whether that there's even an incentive. And then beyond the incentive, there's a question of is that strategy going to be effective? And here we have to look at to the alternatives. Who else is also supplying the same product or service? If the rivals of the merging firm can turn to other sources for the same inputs, well, then that strategy is not going to be very effective at foreclosing competition. And so there are, you have to look at, we'll talk about this a little bit later in the advocacy section, but we have to look at both the incentive to foreclose and the ability to foreclose. There's a related theory, this is the second theory, which is raising rivals' costs. And in this theory, the merging parties don't stop dealing with their rivals, but they raise the cost of the input or whatever they're providing to the rivals. And the idea is that you will either weaken those rivals or will help to raise prices in the downstream market. And this is the theory that was raised in the AT&T Time Warner case. And you may have heard a lot about this idea of increased bargaining leverage. Well, if there's any diversion of downstream sales between the rivals to the merged firm, that will naturally increase the bargaining leverage of the merged firm when it's dealing with its rivals, because there's something it gets if it doesn't make the sale. So every vertical merger will have this, a little bit of that effect. The question and what the court held that the DOJ did not prove in AT&T Time Warner was that incentive was so high that it would actually result in higher prices. What that case establishes is that this raising rivals cost theory, this increased bargaining leverage theory, is viable. It is a theory you have to pay attention to when you have a vertical merger. But just because there is some increased, just because the parties are a little bit better off in bargaining negotiations than they were before the merger, isn't the end of the analysis. You have to see whether that's actually going to result in higher prices. You have to prove that out. There are two more theories, and they sort of, instead of focusing on weakening rivals, they are focused instead on how this relationship might actually cause some sort of coordinated oligopoly behavior or collusive behavior in the downstream market between the merged firm and its rivals. So think now at this level of where we have the orange boxes here. So the obvious one is information exchange. Assume you don't foreclose the rivals, you're still supplying your rivals, but now you're getting access to a lot of their information about their purchases, about their costs, about their future plans, and the result of that supply relationship. You might be able to use that information either to disadvantage those rivals in competition or to somehow coordinate with them and rate, maybe raise prices or reduce output or something like that in the downstream market. And that usually is fixed by something called firewall to prevent that information exchange. There's a fourth theory here that is very rarely discussed. I don't think it's actually discussed in the DOJ guidelines, but it's one that I ran into in the Danone White Wave case. And it's sort of to describe it, I would call it the softening competition theory. And that's the idea that, okay, you have the merger here and the merging party A is continuing to supply all of its, one of its rivals, but that relationship is not just profitable for the merging parties, but it's actually a very important relationship. And as a result of that, they don't want to do anything that's going to upset that vertical supply relationship to the rivals. And so as a result of that relationship, you might actually expect there to be a reduction in downstream competition because maybe they compete more aggressively elsewhere with other rivals or somehow they don't want to upturn the, rock the boat. And as a result of that, there's a softening of competition downstream. That's actually a theory of vertical harm that actually happened in horizontal mergers. You have to sort of think through when you have a deal, does the counterparty to the merger have an important relationship with one of your other competitors? And that's something that hasn't really been on a lot of people's radars when you think about these deals. But if you actually look at the Virgin Alaska deal, that whole deal was a concern about Alaska's relationship with American Airlines, not about the horizontal competition. If you look at Broadcom Brocade, the concern was about a relationship with Cisco. It wasn't about the competition between the parties. And so this sort of fourth rail to vertical merger analysis is that you have to be cognizant of this theory of harm that arises when the other party to the merger has an important relationship with one of your big rivals. So that's the harm side of the equation. And I'll stop there and let's talk about the efficiencies and all the good things about vertical mergers.
Yes, exactly, because that's very clear, Craig, what you are saying. But we heard Michael earlier tell us that vertical mergers are usually efficient. So what about the benefits, Rani?
Yeah, so Craig painted the gloomy side of the equation, but the good news is that there are also significant benefits to vertical mergers that the agencies also put a lot of weight on. So typically in a horizontal deal, you look at the synergies on those deals, and a lot of it tends to be elimination of, I guess, duplication. So you don't need two boards, you don't need two finance departments, two IT groups, things like that. And as a result of those horizontal mergers, you can reduce costs for the companies and help make them more efficient so that they can compete better. In vertical deals, you have those same efficiencies. Again, even though the two companies aren't competing, they might not need two IT departments, for example. But you also have other very significant ones. One is the elimination of double marginalization, which Craig just hinted at. And the other is that there are new incentives created by these vertical mergers that can generate some very significant consumer benefits. Now, a lot of times that's why these companies are coming together. They have products that work together, and by being under one roof, they're able to use that knowledge, and they have more incentive to invest in the R&D and innovation to bring those products to the next level instead of just continuing to buy the raw input or buy this other input into their product. They now will invest in trying to make that product better. And not only does that benefit them, but then what happens is that company will then turn around and sell that better product to everyone else in the marketplace. And so you see very very wide-ranging benefits from that. I think one great example of that was from the CVS Aetna deal. So after the merger, CVS obviously focuses on the pharmacy side, and Aetna was focusing on the medical side. And when you put those two companies together, CVS had a new incentive to introduce more health services into its pharmacies in order to help lower medical spending on the Aetna side. And not only are they providing those services to Aetna, but they're also providing it to Aetna's competitors as well. And so, that's manifested into the opening of 1,500 new what they call health hubs. And those are basically pharmacies where they've taken out a lot of the merchandise and they've added a lot of health services to those stores in order to increase access to healthcare. And then on the EDM side, elimination of double marginalization, this is really just a fancy term that you may have learned back in your microeconomics classes. But the idea is that when you're buying an input from a third party or from a different party, they're going to charge you a markup on that product because they have to make money. And now when you bring those two products under one roof, what it does is it lowers your cost. And when your input costs go down, you then have an incentive to lower your own costs in order to maximize your profits. If you remember your supply and demand and marginal cost curves. So typically what happens as a result of these vertical mergers is you end up with better products, more investments in innovation, and then you also end up with lower prices for consumers. And so all of that is used to offset the potential harm that you see from all of the different theories that Craig talked about. And these were synergies that were actually credited in the AT&T Time Warner decision, the elimination of double marginalization, as well as this sort of innovation efficiency.
Thank you, Rennie. Then, based on that, Michael, what is in the new guidelines by the U.S. agencies? What do you see?
Not a lot that's new. Relatively brief document, 9 pages, and it's relatively consistent with how the agencies have been looking at these issues for years now. They identify the unilateral competitive concerns that Craig mentioned and described, foreclosure, raising levels of costs, access to competitively sensitive information. They identify post-merger coordinated interaction as potential coordinated effects concern. They don't, as Craig mentioned, articulate the softening of competition concern, but they don't purport to be completely exclusive of any other theory. Their guidelines, the agencies have left themselves some room. So there's really not a lot new. What is new is some language. There's a concept of a related product, which is defined as the service that's applied by the merged firm that's vertically related to the products and services in the relevant market, and to which access by the merged firm's rivals affects competition in the relevant market. So it could be, as we've been talking about, an upstream input, a downstream retailer means of distribution, access to a set of customers. There's really nothing new in that except for the terminology. The draft proposes a two-pronged test for what is sort of but not really a safe harbor. What it states is that the agencies are unlikely to challenge a vertical merger where, one, the parties to the merger have a share in the relevant market of less than 20%, and two, their related product at issue is in less than 20% of the relevant market. So that's the statement that's probably produced the most controversy by commentators. Some people say that 20% threshold for the relevant product and the relevant market is too high. Some say it's too low. Some, including our antitrust group at Dechert, have said that you ought to be looking at concentration in addition to just share. So, you know, in essence, the guidelines are intended to provide guidance, but not to limit the agency's ability to depart from them where they see fit. They identify the same concerns that we know are at issue. So it's not really a lot new, some new terminology, and that's, I think, about it. Alec, is the analytical framework much different in Europe?
Well, Michael, thank you for the U.S. description. If I were to be brief, I could simply channel that great film Ghost and say, as Patrick Swayze did, ditto. But you'll recall that Demi Moore was always frustrated with that terse and brief response. So let me yield to the temptation to say a little bit more. Our guidelines, it would be nice to be able to call them vertical guidelines, but just to make life complex, they're called, as I think also in the US, non-horizontal guidelines. So vertical and diagonal or conglomerate. They go back as far as 2008. And as I was saying, no current plan to revisit them. They tell much the same story. It's theories of harm around unilateral effects, normally foreclosure, in particular foreclosure of inputs or foreclosure of customers who might want to get supplies. There are also cases where the concern is that there will be access to information which is prejudicial, where the effects arising would not be unilateral but which would be coordinated effects. That's the same analytical framework that we have. How is it applied in practice? You talked about a safe harbor of 20%. We don't have anything that we actually call a safe harbor, but de facto we get to a similar result because our notification process, the infamous form CO, tells you when you have to supply information in detail on given markets. It has the notion of markets which are, and I say this in quotation marks, affected, where the relationship between the parties is vertical. One is upstream, one is downstream. A market is affected in that sense. If there is a share of 30% held by one party on the upstream market, or equally one held on the downstream market. If you have no vertically affected market because the shares are below those levels, the chances are you don't have to give any detail in the notification. That's de facto a safe harbor. Of course, still a notification obligation, but nothing that's going to get examined too much. It's not an absolute rule. There could be circumstances, particularly if it's a market which is about to explode in significance and scale, where the Commission might want to examine things. What are the recent instances of vertical cases? There's been some emphasis in the relatively small number I mentioned, only 10% of interventions, some relatively large proportion of cases which are TMT, telecoms, media, technology, those being markets where there may be some question of infrastructure which could have a limiting effect. There have been a number of cases where vertical issues were looked at and then not found to need remedying. Microsoft LinkedIn is one. On the other hand, both Liberty Ziggo and the Broadcom Brocade case did lead to remedies being taken. Apple Shazam, a case that was taken to phase two on a vertical concern over Apple's access to information about Shazam users' choices of information and the link to music streaming from Apple, in fact, was closed with no remedies at all. The Commission considered it, in the end, did not need to have gone to phase two, or at least there were no concerns to be remedied on mature consideration. Having said that TMT is the dominant theme, only yesterday we had a deal that's in phase two on vertical issues proceed beyond the stage where Apple Shazam was cleared to a statement of objections. It's a case involving good old-fashioned physical products, spectacle frames and lenses on the one hand, and opticians on the other hand. This is the Essilor Luxottica Grand Vision case, greeted in a particular news report that I read, saying that it's a case which draw rare European charges over a vertical deal. So it was something to write about in particular, if that happens. A case where the parties are fighting in phase two, often they don't fight in phase two, they simply take the easy exit at phase one. So that's Europe in slightly more than a ditto nutshell.
Thank you very much, all. Now that we have a bit of view on the theoretical aspect, let's get practical. What's the process here? Does that have an impact on timing? Rani, what does our so-called dummy tool tell us about that?
So we've been keeping track of what we call the Dechert Antitrust Merger Investigation Timing Tracker, and DAMIT for short, as Laurence pointed out. The point of that tracker is to look at all of the deals since 2011 and measure the timing of those deals. And so we've taken that data and we've compared what does the average length of a vertical deal look like compared to a horizontal deal. And as you can see on slide 10 here, we saw that last year, 2019, vertical mergers were taking about 4 months longer. So 15.3 months from the time the deal was announced to the time that the agency actually made a decision on the merger, whether it was to clear it or to bring a lawsuit or reach a settlement. So, I mean, 4 months is a significant time difference there. And, you know, over the last 10 years, I think we were seeing the difference was around 2.5 months or so. So it's been going up a little bit there. So why are we seeing that difference? I mean, what is it about vertical mergers that are adding time to the process? I think the most, at least to us, we don't have perfect insight into what's going on at the agencies, but from defending these deals, what we see is that there's typically more markets under investigation. So in a horizontal deal, I think the scope of the investigation is fairly well defined, over many years. And that's, you know, you look at the areas, the markets where the two companies compete, and you analyze the competition in just those markets where they compete. Now, what happens in a vertical merger is, you know, as we talked about before, there aren't markets where the two companies compete. So now you're looking at all of the related markets, basically every market where those two companies operate, even if there's no direct head-to-head competition. And you have to do a structural analysis, a competitive landscape analysis of all of those different markets, collect data from all those markets, pose more employees involved in all those markets, reach out to more third-party customers and competitors in those markets. And now, you know, instead of just looking at one narrow market where the two companies compete, you're now looking at several different markets in a vertical deal to understand, you know, is this a market where one of the firms could exercise market power and foreclose its competitors? Do they have an incentive to do that, as we talked about before? So that's why we think we're seeing this difference. And as Michael talked about in the draft vertical guidelines, there's not a clear threshold, you know, or a clear limiting principle under which these markets can just be eliminated and, you know, excluded from the investigation. So these tend to be very broad in scope, and the economic analysis of understanding the interrelationships between the different markets where there isn't competition, that also comes under study as well.
Thanks, Franny. As you know, in Europe, we don't really have a second request. So the question of timing is a bit different, and it's linked more to a strategic choice that the parties have to make. And Alec alluded to that just a minute ago. With time, and we'll see that in a moment, you may have a pretty good chance to alleviate any vertical concerns that the Commission is raising. But of course, it will take months for an economic study, months for a longer market test, as Rani was saying, on many markets. So the parties may have to choose between a clearance in phase one with commitments to remedy potential vertical concerns, or going to phase two and take the time to fight on the vertical aspect of the deal, and usually, not always, but usually end up with narrower remedies or even no remedies at all. And just an example, that's the dilemma we face during the vertical integration of the space sector in Europe. We represented Airbus during the creation of a JV with Safran, and then the subsequent acquisition of Ariane Space. And the objective was to completely vertically integrate the European space industry. And in the first phase of the deal, the parties had a strong timing constraint because the deal had to close before the next plenary session of the European Space Agency. So when the EC started raising vertical issues, they had to make a quick choice to go out with remedies and not go to phase two. Conversely, during the second phase of the deal, the acquisition of Ariane Space, we had much more time. The timing constraint was gone, basically. And so we were able to spend much more time discussing the issues with the Commission by going to phase two. We were able to provide a very comprehensive economic analysis. It gave us the time to reach out to key customers, to lobby toward the European Space Agency to get their full support for the deal. And in the end, the EC abandoned almost all vertical concerns and the remedies were minimal. And I think that's a choice that parties may often have to make when they are dealing with vertical mergers. And that brings me to our next topic, which is how do you improve your prospect for clearance? And here we would really like to walk you through some of the successful and sometimes less successful examples of advocacy that we've seen in vertical deeds. Rani, would you like to go first, please?
Yeah, so I think a lot of the analysis that you see in vertical mergers, a lot of it's speculative. So in a horizontal deal, the agencies will look at sort of the current state of the market. They have a lot of documents from both companies about what that current state of the market is, how the company set their prices, what's likely to happen to prices in the future. In a vertical deal, you are typically talking about a state of the market that doesn't yet exist. So you're bringing together two different parts of the supply chain, and there's not a lot of ordinary course documents that are there. So what you need to really look at are the transactional documents. So, why are the companies actually doing the deals? And, typically what we see in the vertical deals is that there are very strong deal rationales. Like we talked about before, there are significant benefits in these deals. And it's not just the lawyers coming up with these on their own or making them up, but these actually go into deal valuation. If you're able to create a new product that didn't exist before and sell it in the marketplace, that's a significant synergy of the deal. Or if you're able to lower your input costs and now charge lower prices, that's also a significant benefit of the deal. So in CVS Aetna in particular, it took a lot of economic analysis to reach that point to show that the incentive was to continue to offer services to other competitors of Aetna. That's again coming back to these health hubs. Those are stores that didn't exist before the merger, and they only came about because of the merger. And now, they're not only serving Aetna patients, but they also serve other health insurers as well. And so that's a huge innovation in healthcare. And, what we saw was that a lot of competitors, so those could be either doctors or pharmacies coming in, and, they didn't like the deal much, because if you're expanding the access to healthcare, expanding the amount of competition in the marketplace in some of those areas that just competition didn't exist before, then that can lead to lower prices, and competitors don't tend to like lower prices because that means that they might have less profits than they did in the current state of the world. So that was one piece, the economic analysis to look at the incentives. And I think the other key piece was looking at industry retrospectives. So are there examples of companies that have vertically integrated in this space, and did they continue to serve their customers, or did they cut their competitors off, for example, or try to raise prices on them? And so it's very important to look at what happened previously when there was vertical integration in the same marketplace, and be able to show that the incentive there was to continue to service other competitors and not to try to cut them off, foreclose them, and cause all of these theoretical harms that someone might come up with.
Thanks, Rani. Craig, what about document creation? You have a good story on that.
Yes, I'll just give a brief story, but obviously document creation is very important, and the deal team tends to understand document creation in horizontal deals. They understand they're not great at it either. Obviously, there are a lot of bad documents in horizontal cases as well. But vertical issues are much more complicated. They're less intuitive. And so it's important to get in front of the deal team to make sure they understand the vertical theories as well, and they're not creating bad documents that sink your case. For example, in the Danone White Wave case that we worked on, everyone was thinking of this as an expansion of Danone's portfolio into some plant-based products and some new products in the U.S. and things like that. It was looked at very much as a horizontal deal. Still today people talk to me about that case as the yogurt case, as a horizontal overlap in yogurt, but really the consent we had to enter into was based on a vertical theory that wasn't on the other party's radar very much, and we were a little bit sunk by some bad documents. Documents that actually didn't really reflect the views of the company, but by some sort of rather rogue advisor to the company that was offering 2 cents on what they could do with the deal. And so it's just real important that your deal team understands the vertical issues at the start, and that you actually communicate the positive vertical themes as well to everyone else as soon as the deal is announced, so you don't get these wild theories that end up raising concerns.
Thanks. Let me add something here, perhaps. I think one other thing that is peculiar about vertical mergers is the power that they can give to your competitors. As Rennie was saying, usually in horizontal mergers, competitors are afraid of lower prices, and so they're not really taken into account by the agencies. But that can be different in vertical mergers, because there, your competitor is also potentially your customer. And for example, in Europe, still in the space sector, there is a very strong rivalry between Airbus and Thales in satellite, especially. And in any deal that one of the company has done over the past 20 years or so, the other has been a vocal complainant. And that's something that you need to take into account when you think about your vertical deal. Is there someone in the market that will want to make life as difficult as it can be for you? And if that's the case, in practice, you will need to rely on other more objective elements to counter their claims. And that's where I've found in the past that the importance of economics may be higher in vertical mergers than in horizontal cases, because you have to prove in some way that you won't have an incentive to foreclose. And the usual way to do that is generally because it would not be sufficiently profitable for you to foreclose. But Michael, tell us more about your Fresenius next stage case, because I think it's very interesting.
So, our client Fresenius sought to acquire Next Stage, which was the only other U.S. FDA-approved supplier of home hemodialysis equipment. So you should know that home hemodialysis equipment is actually purchased by dialysis clinics and placed in the home of patients who opt to do their own dialysis with training and supervision provided by the clinic. So as a result of the acquisition, Fresenius would have almost a 100% share of this equipment. And that obviously gave rise to some horizontal merger issues of its own. But a vertical issue arose because Fresenius operates a sizable share, maybe 40% of outpatient dialysis clinics in the U.S. And the FTC was curious whether Fresenius would have the incentive and the ability to competitively foreclose rival clinics by denying them access to home hemodialysis equipment, or to raise the price of the equipment to those to super competitive levels to those rivals. So in response, together with our economists, we built a model that examined the hypothetical impact of either complete foreclosure or price premiums of X percent or Y percent, and showed that the economically rational conduct would be to continue to provide home hemodialysis equipment to competitors at competitive levels. And this was a very complex exercise, essentially building potential business models consistent with the FTC's theory and demonstrating why they would be rejected by a rational business. It certainly helped us that there were no facts or business documents suggesting anything to the contrary. The FTC was also interested in whether Fresenius's ownership of NextStage would raise barriers to entry in home hemodialysis equipment. The theory being that potential new entrants into home hemodialysis equipment would find it difficult to enter successfully because they wouldn't have access to all the patients that were being served by Fresenius clinics. And we succeeded in showing that the physicians making purchasing decisions for Fresenius clinics acted independently. And we were also able to show that there was entry that was occurring, but despite the fact of the deal, and that was also helpful. We also had a credible story that Fresenius was in a better position to make important improvements to NextStage's products than NextStage was itself. And it's always nice to have a "we're going to save lives" argument. So just tying together what you, Laurence, and Craig and Ronnie have said in terms of just overall advocacy points, and you can't ignore these questions. It's not as if they're not going to go away. It's not as if in the line of an even better Patrick Swayze movie, nobody puts baby in a corner. The issues are going to come up. So how to improve your prospects for clearance? One, don't have the intention to foreclose competition. Ensure there's nothing in your documents that suggests otherwise. And even better than that, ensure there are things in your documents that affirmatively indicate that you are not intending to foreclose competition or raise rivals' costs, et cetera. Have the business do the modeling of why it would make no economic sense in the short run or the long term to foreclose competition. Reach out to your customers, make them comfortable that they're not going to be foreclosed or otherwise disadvantaged, whether that's by means of a conversation or by means of a long-term supply contract or distribution agreement, find a way to do that. And finally, get the client to understand these are significant issues. If they come to the attention of the agencies, they're going to cost you time, as the gamut data show you, and have everybody reinforcing these points at every time.
Thank you, Michael. We have less than 10 minutes left, so let's imagine for a second that you cannot completely resolve concerns through advocacy. What can you do? What are the remedies here?
Well, I can do this quickly. You really have, if your advocacy isn't working, you've got basically four different things you can do. One, you can find a remedy that's acceptable to the agency and the client, whether that's a divestiture or a contractual commitment or a firewall. Two, you can litigate, and three, you can drop the deal. So let's rule out three, because that's not what you want to do. In terms of remedies, we've talked about it a little bit already. The conduct remedies are frequently accepted. They've not been accepted at DOJ recently. DOJ has been allowing deals to go through with divestitures. United Technologies had to divest its optical systems in order to get import foreclosure concerns satisfied in connection with Raytheon. A buyer had to divest some seed treatments with concerns about foreclosure to some of Monsanto's customers. At the FTC, firewalls remain a possibility. Staples Ascendant, a firewall was the remedy that solved for the FTC the information access issues, for example. Litigation is an option. AT&T Time Warner is an example of a case in which the DOJ sued to block the deal rather than accept a non-structural fix, and the DOJ lost that case. And that loss may have contributed to DOJ's perhaps shying away from bringing the Sabre Prologis case as a vertical case, and also in it losing that case because the court was not satisfied that DOJ had actually defined a relevant product market in which the parties were horizontal competitors. To many of us, that looked far more like a vertical deal than a horizontal deal. Those are really the choices. Remedies are different at the agencies right now. Litigation is a possibility. It's a high-risk strategy. And dropping the deal isn't really what anybody wants to do. Alec, let's turn to Europe. Litigation isn't really an option. Are the remedies any different in Europe?
The principle, Michael, is the same, that the agency, the European Commission, will always prefer a structural remedy if one is available. And actually, I say European Commission, but the same is true pretty much across Europe at national level as well. It's a pretty consistent pattern. Better to divest something so that you don't have to keep an eye on it in terms of monitoring. But behavioral commitments remedies are sometimes accepted, and they are more likely to be accepted in a vertical case. If it's a question of information flow, it may mean maybe no more than putting in a Chinese wall. And in relation to monitoring, it's true, of course, that there is an inbuilt monitoring mechanism because there are third parties interested in the effectiveness of the remedy who can be some kind of canary in the coal mine for the European Commission. If there is a problem with the remedy, it will be brought to attention. What is really different, though, Michael, as you say, litigation is not an option, is the procedural context, because the issue in the European Commission, we touched on this, Laurence touched on it indeed, as well as me earlier, is that you may be able to get out at phase one with a remedy. You can go to phase two, you might escape the remedy, but phase two is going to add 5 months into your deal schedule, and it's an issue which is driven by the commercial circumstances. You may be quite happy to get out at phase one, and we've seen that in a number of cases. As I mentioned a moment ago, the case going on, EssilorLuxottica Grand Vision, is a case where the parties are all the way in phase two arguing about vertical issues. So if we come back to this webinar platform in a year's time, I may have a story to tell around that.
Thanks, Alec. We're almost running out of time, but let's try to wrap it up with the last question, which is, how do you know whether your vertical merger is likely to get scrutiny either in the US or in Europe? Craig?
Sure. So the obvious screen is if there are few alternatives to which your competitors can turn for that input or that other thing that's valuable to competition, then the deal is going to face higher risk. But I wanted to put on everyone's radar, there's other things that companies ought to look at. First, if the distribution chain is very complex, you could take, for example, healthcare, where you have providers of health services that are working together in groups that are then working together with hospitals that are then working together with insurers and then working together with providers of medical devices and pharmaceuticals. You can see a bunch of different ways in which vertical integration might happen there, and there may be a variety of different vertically integrated entities along the chain that you have to look at as the alternatives. As a result of that, just looking into that, the vertical issues and something that complex is going to take time. And so even if there's not an issue, that's something that could result in scrutiny because it's going to take a long time to explain. Agriculture I put on here for a couple of reasons, but agriculture could be looked at in the same way. You have farmers producing products that then have to go to some plant for processing, that then have to go to, some packer who's going to turn it into products that's going to then be created into some product that's marketed and branded and then distributed to retail, grocery. You can see how a lot of those areas of level to distribution in the chain can create a lot of complexity for analyzing the foreclosure issues. Bottlenecks is really no different than the first point I made. If there are a few alternatives for your rivals to turn to in the case of foreclosure, then there's going to be an issue. But you should obviously pay attention when you're in an industry that has, that features certain transportation bottlenecks, processing bottlenecks, or something else like that. Another area that you should be sensitive to is if you're in an industry in which there are long, contentious negotiations over long-term contracts, in which the parties, often walking away from the table, but ultimately coming back, and coming up with an agreement. The raising rivals cost theory, the bargaining leverage, increased bargaining leverage theory is something that you could have to answer in those type of deals when those other parties to those contentious negotiations are likely to complain about your deal. Single homing, the idea there is whenever they're, consumers are locked into some platform or some, it could be an insurer, or it could be someone else where you have to go through a certain party to reach a certain group of customers. Even if there are many other customers you could reach through other channels, there could be an issue of whether that vertical integration there forecloses all the rivals from getting access to that group of customers. And so you should be also looking at vertical issues when you have that fact pattern. And then finally, I just want to touch on next generation technology. We hear a lot about killer acquisitions and nascent acquisition mergers in the horizontal sense, and where the theory is that but for the acquisition, these nascent technology would rise up and become the new big player in the industry. Well, there's also a vertical theory there. Maybe Sabre Farelogix was a better case if it was brought that way, where you're somehow one firm is taking out some new technology that would otherwise be available to everyone else in the industry, and therefore preserving the position of the incumbent who has market power as a result of capturing this new technology before it's made available to everyone else. So there's a vertical issue with nascent technology mergers as well as a horizontal issue.
Alec, a few words about the EU before we conclude.
That time is short, I will limit myself to one word, ditto.
Thank you very much. I think it's a very good conclusion. Thank you very much to everyone for your attention. If we've not been able to answer all your questions, please feel free to follow up with any of our speakers afterwards. We would also be grateful for your feedback. I think a questionnaire will be pop up on your screen or something like that just after we finish. Let me thank you again and wish you a good day.
Thank you. I just wanted to take this opportunity to thank all the speakers, Laurence, Michael, Craig, Ronnie and Alec. Very insightful presentation and very useful, I'm sure, for the attendees. Just as a reminder, we will be sending out a link containing the recorded session. So please keep an eye out for that. And as mentioned before, please send the link on to any colleagues who may be interested in today's presentation. Thank you and enjoy the rest of your day.